When historians look back on our time, we can be pretty confident about some of the things they'll see, mostly because it's a similar list to what they remember about another time, the Gilded Age. The obscenely wealthy, and the profiteers who pretend to be among them, the legions who can't pretend, and the fight for their rights as workers, or as citizens. Our inability to end the nightmare through politics.
Right. So now,
mail service delivers 185 million people.
Not just because of corruption, but because of division.
You could put half of Trump supporters into what I call the basket of deplorables.
The sort of vision of misbegotten wealth is characteristic of what people think of now when they hear the phrase the Gilded Age.
Now for a cruise around Manhattan Island, not on a sightseeing boat, but on a private yacht.
These vast fortunes being piled up at the same time as conditions for, in particular, an urban immigrant poor and an industrial working class deteriorate in terrible ways. These are social phenomena that seem vaguely reminiscent in our own period as wages have declined, as CEO wealth has massively increased warehousing homelessness in a way that makes it less visible, even though it's more acute.
The comparison has become useful shorthand for politicians and pundits who are trying to describe the divide at the heart of our time.
We are today now, in essence, in another Gilded Age.
Another Gilded Age.
This isn't just a spiffy way to describe the present.
As a second Gilded Age.
It's a way to talk about what could come next.
When people make the comparison, very often there's an implication.
The implication being that the second Gilded Age could end the same way the first one did, with a new era of change.
The Progressive Era is generally known as a period of great reform.
Greatest headlines of the century.
Reforms to workplace safety and hygiene, labor protections, political reforms that expanded direct democracy, the passage of a graduated income tax. These are the kinds of reforms that people think of generally.
But politicians and reporters who are now calling for a new progressive era often leave out some of the messier truths of the first one.
There were certain kinds of progressive reform that were progressive by the standards of the day, but is premised on a certain kind of way of thinking that actually reproduces the forms of inequality that the reform ostensibly attacks.
Like a law that limited working hours for women, but was based on the dubious idea that women are weaker than other workers. And then there was the 19th Amendment, which, yes, gave women the right to vote, but passed in part because it was popular with racists who thought votes from white women would cancel out the votes of black men.
People who imagine that the progressive era addressed inequality in a way that could be replicated now have to take a really hard look at the fact that inequality continued expanding.
Never in the long history of this struggle has farm labor been given the immense amounts of money and organizational support needed.
Inequality is rising and has been rising in our own era.
Still, the progressive era can teach us ways to climb out of a Gilded Age, as long as we look in the right places.
People generally think that the reforms of the progressive era emerged from rational discussion among experts. People have forgotten that actually many of the transformations that came about in the progressive era were the result of sustained violence. Tens of thousands of people died in workplace accidents every single year between the 1880s and the 19-teens. And that creates its own kind of social dynamic in which violence becomes a certain kind of language that people use to express dissent. Strikes themselves were often much more violent affairs. In many cases, the business owners who were attempting to break the strike would hire private armed guards or in fact pay the police directly in order to beat workers who were on the picket lines. You see constant stories about attempted dynamitings on the part of workers who were addressing injustices in their workplaces. much of the political impetus came from moments of real crisis that were precipitated by organizations of working class people and of immigrants who were pushing for transformation from below.